Welcome to the Potter's House, Christian Fellowship Church, on this beautiful Sunday night. It's good to be in the house of God, amen, tonight. It's great to have all of you with us online, digitally. Praise God. I want to make you aware that we will be online every single service, 10:30 on Sunday morning, 6:30 on Sunday night, and 7 o'clock on Wednesday. We also have a website. It's PottersHouseOhio.com. You can go there and get all the information about us as a church, when we're open, what's happening with COVID-19, and all of those other more pertinent things. We also want to let you know that even though we're not meeting physically in person, we still have obligations as a church, and so we're asking that you continue to be faithful with your tithes and offerings, believing God with us to bring us through these difficult times. I know Ohio is in lockdown and starting tomorrow night. And so we just have to keep in mind that we have priorities still. And that's God, the God that we serve, heaven, our ultimate goal. So we're welcoming all of you out tonight. And we're going to open with a word of prayer. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you. Praise you for all that you're doing in our midst. God, we know that you're able to use these rough times, God, to draw people to yourself. God, I pray that you would draw hearts. God, that you would beckon people that would not necessarily give you a second look. You would beckon them to come unto you at this during this very, very difficult time. I pray, God, you would bring revival to the United States of America, yea, even the world. But God, move in this place tonight. God, have right of way and dominion in our midst. God, your presence would be here. God, help us in our community. And God, help us. We're praying for those that are sick in body. We're believing, God, for those that have cancer that are in our church. We're praying for others right now that we have prayer requests for. We're believing God to move by his Spirit tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to preach something tonight that I've entitled The Highest Privilege. We are in lockdown officially in Ohio, people. Shelter in place is the more irritating term. In spite of that happening tomorrow night at 11:59, I am blessed. I'm blessed beyond my wealthy peers. And I'm not just blessed for the moment or simply having a good day. I'm literally living life in the supernatural, extraordinary, real life as it should be lived. And it is a privilege to serve the God that we serve. It is a privilege to pray to the God that we serve. And living beyond your limitations is a Christian lifestyle. It should be a worldview. Come on, somebody. A constant state of being, a fluent pattern of convergence where everything happening in your life seems to have no physical boundaries.
Amen.
There seems to be no actual limits to what can happen. Sound good so far? I'm living in faith, yes. Tangible, evidentiary faith that never seems to know mortality. A faith that shouts of dominion and the favor of God. And this is the pattern of life as elucidated throughout the Word of God, where God reveals himself in the transcendent and so desperately wants you and me to live it, amen, to live in it, to know it intimately, to never turn back, to never give up, because truly there is no end. And we worship and serve a God that has no limits, church. And I know that it's hard to imagine, because most of our frustrations in life are a direct result of limitations. Our own limitations, mostly. Nature's, the cosmos, the flesh. And as you get older, I realize even gravity is against me. But the reality tonight is that prayer and communication with God and the ability to touch the creator of the universe, amen, by speaking his name, is the highest privilege granted to any human being ever. In Ezekiel chapter 36, which will be our text tonight, Ezekiel chapter 36, I want to preach a message I've entitled The Highest Privilege. And this is what the Lord God says, verse 33. On the day that I wash away your sins, I will bring people back to your cities. The ruined cities will be rebuilt. People will begin again to work the land, so when other people pass by, they will not see ruins anymore. They will say, in the past, this land was ruined, but now it is like the Garden of Eden. The cities were destroyed. They were ruined. They were empty. But now they're protected and they're inhabited. This is the Lord God speaking through prophecy through Ezekiel. Then the nations, verse 36, then the nations that are still around you will know I am the Lord, that I rebuilt those places, that I replanted this land that was empty, that I am the Lord, I have spoken, and I will do it. This is what the Lord God says. I will also allow the house of Israel to ask of me to do this for them. I will make them grow and become many people. They will be like flocks of sheep. See, this is our text. God is about to do a great thing for Israel. But two things are being spoken here. Number one, prayer is a privilege. Verse 37, I will also allow the house of Israel to ask of me to do this great thing for them. So number two, before God will accomplish it, he needs to be asked. He needs to be inquired of. God is declaring that as a preliminary. There needs to be an inquiry. You want me to do this? You want me to save this virus? You want me to save America? You want me to save Israel? You want me to rebuild the ruined lands? Then you ask me. You ask this of me. And I will do it, says the Lord. Are we a people that is willing to ask of God to do such a great thing? Something he already desires to do. He just needs a people that will ask him, are you a people tonight that will ask God to do this great thing?
Amen.
Before God even extends to us the privilege of prayer, he is already conveying to us that he has every intention of answering it. You can read that in verse 37 of our text. Before God will bless, he must be asked. And the old saying goes, if you worry, you didn't pray. And if you pray, don't worry. As a child of God, prayer is kind of like calling home every day. It's such an amazing privilege. Three things we must remember when we pray. The love of God wants what's best for us. The wisdom of God knows what's best for us. Amen? And the power of God can accomplish all of it, thirdly. See, prayer is a forerunner of mercy. And no great mercy comes to this world without first great prayer. The Welsh revival started in prayer and converted an entire nation to Christ. The prayers of John Wesley was said to have saved England from war. Peter was released supernaturally from prison in response to a prayer meeting. There's a high privilege in calling upon God tonight. I said there's a high privilege in calling upon the Lord tonight.
Amen.
The rebirth of the Pentecostal movement in modern times, the Azusa Street Revival, was founded as a simple prayer meeting. You see, in 1905, a small group of African-American believers hungry for revival were expelled from the Second Baptist Church in Los Angeles. And eventually, they began meeting in a home on Bonnie Bray Street, where the stirrings of revival and the spiritual manifestations began to draw an increasing number of seekers. The unlikely leader of this group was a humble, uneducated son of a former slave named William Joseph Seymour. For Seymour, the message of the hour was a renewal of Pentecost, as evidenced by the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Oh, come on, somebody. Amen. Accompanied by speaking in other tongues. And as the word of revival fire, how many know God responds to a people that want to be filled with the Holy Ghost?
Amen.
And as the word of revival fire begins to sweep across the city of Los Angeles, the growing crowds overwhelmed the Bonnie Bray Street home. And the need for a larger facility was evident. Finally, a vacant, rundown building at 312 Azusa Street was located and rented. Although it had formerly housed the African Methodist Episcopal AME Church, the 40 by 60 two-story structure had fallen into disrepair and was being used by a contractor as a warehouse for construction materials and a stable for hay and stock, livestock. But within a few days, with sawdust on the floor, straw matting around the altar, and two wooden shoeboxes for a pulpit, the first service at the Azusa Street Mission opened on Saturday, April 14th, 1906. From the beginning, the sovereign touch of God was upon William Seymour and those who were with him. For 3 years, the revival continued essentially 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. How many know prayer makes a difference? Amen. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, with at times more than 1,000 in attendance every day. People came from all over the world to receive their Pentecost. Many being overwhelmed spiritually before they ever reached the building. And what has been termed the world's greatest revival has in our day resulted in a vast army of over 600 million spirit-filled believers touching every nation on earth. See, you have found this perhaps to be true in your own life. You have found in your own personal experience the high privilege of prayer. You've found God answering prayer. You've laid hold of God in your prayer life. You've seen God move on your behalf. God has given you unsolicited favor. Yes, but still prayer has always been the prelude of mercy upon your life. Your prayers or others praying for you. When you first found peace through the blood of the cross, when you were a new convert and you realized the state of your depraved heart for the very first time, you prayed much, earnestly interceded with God that he would remove your doubts, that he would deliver you from your distresses, forgive you and heal your life. I think I'd been saved almost a year before I came to the true realization of my depraved heart before salvation. I got to the point where I just finally realized how God saw me as a sinner. And I began to weep. See, your assurance that you are saved, your understanding today that you are forgiven, all of that is a result of prayer, church. When at any time have you ever been truly happier and have great joy? You're obligated to give credit where it's due, to look into the face of God, to look upon them as answers to your prayers. When you have heard great deliverance out of maybe money troubles or marriage issues, stupidity, and even great help in dangerous circumstances, you've been able to say, I sought the Lord, and he heard me out and delivered me from all my fears. My family and I spent 4 years in Africa. And let me tell you, during that time, there had been lots of perilous situations that God has delivered us out of. We were broken down at the edge of the Kalahari Desert. We drove through the flames of fire in the midst of a huge brush fire in the plains of Africa. We'd been broken down at the only water hole in a game reserve with all the animals, the elephants and rhinos and Cape Buffalo, on their way to us. And we have a flat tire. I've been chased by an elephant. I've been chased by rhino. I've had to pray in a hurry. I've had to pray quickly and severely. God, you got to move like right now. As you're looking in the mirror and this rhino is coming upon your vehicle, and the mirror says, objects in the mirror are closer than they appear. There's not a lot of time to pray. I sought the Lord, and he heard me. And he delivered me from my fears. See, prayer is always the preface to blessing. One man said it goes before the blessing as the blessing's shadow. When the sunlight of God's mercies rises upon our necessities, it casts the shadow of prayer far down upon the plain. Prayer is the highest privilege. Prayer is connected with blessing by Scripture on purpose to show us the value and the privilege of being able to pray and actually speak with the Creator of the universe, actually speak to God. Ezekiel 36, verse 37, thus says the Lord God, I will also let the house, I will allow the house of Israel to acquire me to do this for them. I will increase their men like flock. I'll do it, but I'll expect that they ask. Isn't God the gentleman? I'll do it. Trust me, I'll do it, but I'll expect that they ask. The New English translation to verse 37 in our text goes like this. This is what the sovereign Lord says. I will allow the house of Israel to ask me to do this for them, and I will multiply their people like sheep. If we had the blessings of God without asking, without prayer, without an understanding of the cost paid to provide for them, it is possible that we would take them for granted and perhaps hardly even notice the source of them. But like water in the desert, the thirsty always appreciate a good source of water. That's prayer.
Amen.
In the same way, prayer makes the mercy of God more precious than diamonds. I don't think America has been in a place in a very long time where we needed to pray like we do right now. I've lived these 57 years, and not one time have I ever been in lockdown because of a worldwide pandemic. We appreciate answers to prayer in every way they come, realizing their true value. The things we ask for are precious, but sometimes you don't realize their preciousness until we've sought them earnestly, contended for them in our spirit and in prayer. Nobody appreciates a car more than someone who's gone without one for a while. Nobody appreciates, a coat till they've been out in the cold for a while. Amen. I can remember friends of ours in Africa named the Hanstons. They went 6 months with no vehicle because of some issues and walking with the Zambians everywhere they went, which was a great blessing to them. And they talked about great things. But I'm going to tell you, they surely appreciated when that car came. I wonder if you have it in you tonight to pray. I mean, to really pray, to see it as the highest privilege. We're talking about running to fall on our knees, to lay hold of God, to see this as the privilege it is. In the following passage in Judges chapter 16, you can turn there if you have your Bible. We're going to get there in a moment. Judges chapter 16, verse 25 through 30. In the following passage, we see a Bible character we're all familiar with named Samson. He'd been captured. This is after his prime, shall we say. This is after the prime of his life, where all the heroics of Hercules were written about. He'd been captured, humiliated, and treated as an animal, worse than death. He was ridiculed daily, blinded, and completely without dignity. When Samson prayed one last prayer, Judges 16, verse 25 through 30, the story goes, so it happened when their hearts were merry that they said, call for Samson, that he can come and perform for us. So they called for Samson from the prison, and he performed for them. And they stationed him between the pillars. Then Samson said to the lad, the young boy who held him by the hand, said, let me feel the pillars which support the temple so that I can lean on them. Now the temple was full of men and women. All the lords of the Philistines were there, about 3,000 men and women on the roof watching while Samson performed. Then Samson called to the Lord, saying, oh, Lord God, remember me, I pray. Strengthen me, I pray, just this once, oh God. Have you ever prayed with that kind of fervence? That kind of virility? That kind of desperation? That I may with one blow take vengeance on the Philistines for my two eyes. And Samson took hold of the two middle pillars which supported the temple, and he braced himself against them, one on his right and the other on his left. And then Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. As he pushed with all of his might, the temple fell on the lords and all the people who were in it. So the dead that he killed at his own death were more than he had killed in his life. Consider this. What kind of sport that they would call upon him to perform, we cannot tell. We don't know. It's not listed. Probably it was an exhibition of his prodigious strength. This seems to be intimated by what is said. Perhaps they would mock him, throw things at him, ridicule him. Maybe clowns would run around like in a rodeo and try to get him angry. He's blind. He couldn't see them coming. Maybe, who knows what it was? But in Judges 16:22, it says, however, the hair on his head began to grow after it had been shaven. So we know his hair was growing. So we know God had given his strength back to him. So he understood by his hair growing that the source of his strength was coming back. He could feel it. And so there was probably some strength feats that were happening. But I would imagine that Samson, had it been myself, I would have held back. I would not have performed at the level that I could, saving that perhaps for this one last great moment when he would call upon the Lord, get his heart right, and ask God for this one last prayer, this one last thing, this significance, perhaps unknown to his captors, of the respiration, the restoration of his hair meant something and had begun to happen. And this was the source of his strength, sealed in the Nazarite vow. And they made him entertain them, using no doubt the things, exertions he was obliged to make, probably setting up a final act. His final act of humanity on the earth. And some think he was brought out to be a laughingstock, and others have written that he was mocked and insulted by the Philistines. They would throw things at him, perform like a circus act, laugh and ridicule him, but his heart was made, was to make impact still one more time. He had one more prayer left in him. Even in his state of shame, his state of ridicule, even in the state of depravity, if we will summon up even one last prayer, we can defeat hell. So here is Samson. He was on a grinding mill, chained. With his strength, he would push this great stone wheel around in a circle, blinded, not able to go or stray beyond the chain. In a circle, he would push this thing around. And the whole time, God was speaking to him. The Nazarite vow was coming into play. His strength was returning. His hair was growing. He was humiliated. He understood what God had made him to be compared to what he had become because of his disobedience. He was repentant. His heart was broken. He was absolutely at a loss when, as one day, he was led out to perform. And he said, this is it. more. This isn't going to happen. I will not die without my dignity. And he asked the young boy that's leading him around, put me between the pillars. He stretches out his hand on the left. Southern on the right, the young boy helps him to touch the pillars. He can feel. Now he's between them. They're both there. There's room. There's strength. And Samson digs deep into a broken heart, into a rebellious, disobedient heart, into a heart that had failed God and ended up a captive of his own making. And he reached into that heart. And he dug into that heart as he's pressing against the pillars. And he reaches deep enough in his knowledge of God, in his heart for God, in his relationship with God. He says, oh God, one last time. God, can you please restore my strength? Let me be fruitful once again. God, help me this one last time. Answer my prayer. Cry from his heart of hearts to the God of heaven, the highest privilege he had forgotten in his rebellion. He cried out and God answered him and blessed him and returned and restored to him his strength. And he became what he was always supposed to be, the judge over the Philistines. Samson called to the Lord, oh Lord, remember me, I pray. Strengthen me, I pray. Just this once, oh God, that I may with one blow take vengeance on the Philistines for my two eyes. Do you have even one more prayer left in you? Maybe you think you're at the end of your rope. Maybe you think this is too much to handle. Maybe you have no idea what 14 days in your situation locked down is going to look like. Maybe like Samson, you're in a blinded state. You can't see a way out of your circumstances. Perhaps you feel weak, that there's just no more strength left in you to fight. You're tired of fighting. You're tired of your circumstances. You're tired of your life. You've given into your capacity. You'll feel you'll never be free. You'll never be restored. You'll never be what you could possibly be. I wonder at that moment, in the midst of that hurt, that heart, that pain, that brokenness, can you summon the strength in the midst of your circumstances to get hold of God just one more time? Do you have one more prayer?
Amen.
Left in you. Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. And he pushed with all his might. And the temple fell, and the lords and all the people. And he was more fruitful upon his death than he was in life. You understand the significance of that? His destiny, his calling before the Lord was to eradicate the Philistines and deliver the Israelites from the grip of their enemy. And in that last, listen to me, in that last desperate prayer, his life finally made impact. Delilah, a distant memory. Rebellion. Arrogance cast down. A heart that only had room for God cried out in that last prayer. And he made impact. He had accomplished more in one desperate prayer to the Lord. I said he accomplished more in one desperate prayer to the Lord than he had his entire life of calling before that moment.
Amen.
The Lord had moved powerfully. that today. If you can just gather the strength in the midst of your battles, in the midst of your fears, in the midst of your doubts, in the midst of your struggles, in the midst of your finances, your marriage, in the midst of whatever it is that you're involved in, if you can just gather that strength for the highest privilege afforded to believers tonight, one more. Spirit of God is in this place. He loves you. He died for you so that you can have eternal life. There is nothing that is outside of the bounds of God. There is nothing that is beyond where God wants to take you. There's nothing that's beyond what God can forgive. The Bible says that God can take your sins, that Jesus Christ died on the cross. He can take your sins and cast them into the depths of the sea, as far as the east is from the west. Old things are passed away and all things become new. I got born again in 1983. I bowed my knee without any understanding of what I was doing, but knowing desperately that something needed to change. I got fired from McDonald's by my own brother. I got drunk and got a DUI and got kicked out of the house, all in the same time period. All of my bridges that were so lavishly handed to me as I was growing up in middle class America in Dover, Ohio, all of those bridges were collapsing. They were burning. They were falling apart in front of me. And I was left in a desperate state. And that's when God began to cry out to me, and I would say to you tonight that he was already chasing me. He was already on his way to capture me. And I would say that all of the calamities that befell me in that brief period of time were allowed by God as he purposely took away the hedge so that I could come to a place where I could see him, where I could look up to him, where I would be desperate enough to call his name. And in March of 1983, I gave my life to Jesus Christ. In a little Bible study in a house in Denison, Ohio. And let me tell you something, God has brought me to such heights from that point on. God has done such a work in my life. If he can do that in me, some arrogant, snot-nosed kid from Dover, Ohio, how much more can he do for you? I've preached the word of God in 25, 30 some odd countries all over the world, 5 continents. I've preached the word of God. I've seen God do miracles and heal bodies and touch entire villages. I've seen whole generations set free by the power of God. I've seen the blind see, the deaf hear, and the mute speak. I've seen the addict set free and delivered and made whole in a moment of time. I've seen a raging alcoholic trade 1,000 beer cans in for furniture in his household so he could be normal. Set free he was. I want to tell you something. I serve the God of heaven that is so powerful. He can do anything for you. If you're not saved, you're not born again, you're not right with God, you need to come to him right now. And all you have to do is acknowledge this and pray this prayer with me. Bow your head, close your eyes, and repeat these words. And if you'll mean it in your whole heart, he will save you tonight. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Fill me with your spirit. I believe that you died for me and rose from the dead. And I accept your gracious gift of salvation. Forgive me. Cleanse me. Set me free. Make me whole. Come inside my heart and live inside of me. Give me the strength and the power to live for you the rest of my days. God, give me the wisdom to know what to do from now on with my new life. I thank you, Jesus, for touching me, for saving me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer for the first time tonight, I just wonder if you'd acknowledge that somehow on the Facebook comments so that we can pray for you and we can believe God for you and we can give you the best possible chance of making it in the kingdom of God. Listen, it's not in the middle of a global pandemic. It's not the time to be rebellious. It's not the time to fall apart. It's not the time to fall short. It's the time to fall to your knees and get a hold of God. It's the time to be a Christian and show the world that we have the strength inside of us to not only make it through this time, but to pray our way right out of it, to pray this pandemic gone. If you have the power within your heart, Christian, to summon once again one more prayer, do so. God can use that prayer to change your life. And you can be more fruitful from one prayer answered by God than in all the efforts you've ever made on your own. We'll see you Wednesday night. God bless you. It's great to be in the house of God with you. This is Pastor Tom Cunningham from the Potter's House. Have a great night. Thank you.